Okay, so if you remember last time, we discussed the Bill of Rights, Articles 1 through 10, with the exception of 6. And the reason I left 6 out is because on its face, it appears to be almost an orphan among those first 10. If we read the first 10, they talk about the purpose of government, that the legislature is not supposed to make laws unless they leave every member of the community no worse off than if there were no government, the sanctity of natural rights, the extreme unalienable nature of rights of conscience, including religion particularly, and the fact that if the government, the contractual nature, that if somebody surrenders up some of their natural rights for the protection of others, and the government doesn't follow through with the protection, that the surrender is void. And we get to Article 10, which talks about the obligation of revolution. So we look at Article 6. Article 6 was heavily amended back in the mid-60s. I just need to step over here and take one of these so I can make sure I quote it correctly. Now, from 1784 until 1968, the introductory sentence read like this: as morality and piety, rightly grounded on evangelical principles, will give the best and greatest security to government and lay in the hearts of men the strongest obligations to due subjection. And I read that, and here this is tucked in the midst of all these articles which speak of government being from the people, liberty, personal sovereignty. And now we're talking about laying the hearts of men the strongest obligations to due subjection. And what were they talking about? I started wrestling with this really the winter after I had finished the first edition of the commentary. And I had agreed to speak down at the in Lexington on Patriots Day. And the fellow who had invited me down to speak also happened to be my pastor, and he had given me a copy of the Geneva Bible. Now, most of you growing up were probably told that the King James Version of the Bible was the first time that the Bible was divided into chapter and verse and able to be referenced by the people. It was the first Bible for the common people. But that's not true. The King James Version is actually a knockoff on the first Bible. So prepared. The first Bible so prepared was the Geneva Bible. And what happened was, in the 1530s, you have a great conflict going back and forth in England where with it sometimes is Roman Catholic and sometimes it's Protestant, and it's where they were first beginning to actually translate the Bible into common tongue, and in that case English. And that was the Wycliffe Bible. Well, in one of the Wycliffe was before that, but it was only New Testament. And so in one of the swings, when they swing back to Roman Catholicism, they expel all of the Protestants from England, and that included John Calvin. Calvin flees to Geneva, Switzerland. At the same time, Constantinople falls to the Muslims, and all of the Eastern Orthodox flee west, and they collide in Geneva. The Eastern Orthodox had been keeping all of the original text. They weren't working from the Latin Vulgate, they had the Greek and Hebrew scriptures. And Calvin and his crew, suddenly they're confronted with the original text scriptures. And they're just absolutely fascinated. Yes?
What year are we talking about?
We're talking the 1530s, or 1520s maybe. And so they start reading the Greek and Hebrew scriptures, and they start translating from those, and by 1539, they had finished their translation of the complete Bible from Genesis to Revelation. And then they spent
this thing they were starting with was different from what they had had before.
Yes.
Where did the stuff they had before come from?
The Roman Catholic Church.
Okay.
the Latin Vulgate Bible.
Ah.
So, 1539, they complete it. For the next 60 years, they write commentary on it. And, I mean, if you read, I didn't bring my Geneva Bible, if you read the New Testament, half the page is commentary. I mean, they really, and they manually center column referenced it so that you knew in the New Testament how it referred back to the Old Testament. I mean, there was a huge amount of work that went in over 60 years. 1599, they concluded the Geneva Bible, and this was the Bible that the pilgrims used. This was, you know, where Protestant evangelicalism came from. And it was the Bible that was carried over to the United States, and it was the principal Bible of the United States into the 1800s. King James Bible actually took the Geneva, used most of the text, but made certain word changes. For instance, in every place in the King James Bible that you see the word repent, in the Geneva it says amend. Amend means to change for the better, whether you like it or not. It's just you change for the better. Repent at the time that it was substituted had only the connotation to feel bad about. Because it was substituted into what was at that time the Geneva Bible, it assumed the context of changing. And if you look at 1700 period Bibles, dictionaries, you find that repent means to feel bad about, and in the theological context, to change. So that was an acquired meaning. There are other variety of texts that King James changed in the Bible in a manner that made him a little less accountable.
So the thing started with the Catholic Church kind of bringing it along in some form, and then the Protestants then decided they made some changes.
Well, the Roman Catholics translated the Greek and Hebrew to Latin. And that's what everybody worked with until all of a sudden in the 1520s and 30s, the Calvinists and the Eastern Orthodox collided in Geneva, and they were suddenly confronted with the original text of the scriptures. But what's important here, now we get to our Constitution, and it says morality and piety rightly based on evangelical principles. So here I am getting ready for my talk down in Lexington, and I'm pondering, what the heck did they mean by evangelical principles? And I thought about it, and you'll notice also it's a lowercase e, so it's a general term, not a specific term. I thought about, I grew up in a congregational church. What makes a evangelical church different from, say, a Roman Catholic church? Well, in an evangelical church, they elect their leadership, their pastors. In a Roman Catholic church, or any canon law church, Church of England, they appoint their leadership from the top down. So all of a sudden, if you broaden this is a broad term because it's lowercase e, is not referring to a particular religion. Evangelical principles means bottom-up government, church and civil. So morality and piety, rightly grounded on bottom-up government, church and civil, will give the best and greatest security to government and lay in the hearts of men the strongest obligation to due subjection. Well, what is that due subjection? It's the subjection of those in the government to the governed, and the subjection of everyone to God, and legislators, leaders, who are aware of that subjection, will not make laws that will cause the people to rebel, and therefore, government is secure. It actually follows with wonderful logic if you put yourself in their shoes. Remember what I discussed in the first class? When you're trying to understand the Constitution, it was written several hundred years ago, you have to sit down in their shoes and say, how were they thinking when they wrote this? What did this mean to them? And keep in mind, they were trying to pack as much information into as few words as practicably possible.
Never know it from this.
Okay. So, yeah, we go on with the original writing. It says, as knowledge of this is, again, and this is important because this was amended in 1968, and when they did the amendment, they struck some language because they thought it was obsolete sectarian language. They also really destroyed, textually destroyed the article because they had no concern for what was actually being said. So it goes on, and as knowledge of these is most likely propagated through a society by the institution of the public worship of the deity and of public instruction in morality and religion, therefore, to promote these important purposes, the people of this state have the right to empower and do hereby fully empower the legislators to authorize from time to time the several towns, parishes, bodies, corporate, and religious societies within this state to make adequate provision at their own expense for the support and maintenance of public Protestant teachers of piety, religion, and morality. This was actually the authorization for public education, because it was the legislature who gave the authority to create these schools. This is the article under which we created our first public schools. And it's, there are those in the, shall we say, the legal community who like to say that this pertains only to church schools. However, you notice the first thing in that list is towns. So it doesn't refer just to parishes, bodies, corporate. Now that is one of the things that when the article was rewritten, towns were struck out of the list. So now it does only refer to religious schools.
In 1968.
In 1968, but originally it included everything. There's also some other little funny things. In the time, the state, you know, is mostly centered around what's now Rockingham County, but there were settlements throughout what's now New Hampshire. But a lot of the settlements were created around churches. And still, if you go to an unincorporated place and you create a town around a church, the elders of the church have the same powers as selectmen. And the church has the power to institute a property tax. This is still in our statutes. I've tried to get it amended, but it hasn't flown yet.
Just a quick introduction. Are you going to get into where we got the SAUs from?
I can tell you where SAUs are from.
No,
this has nothing to do with SAUs. We're just talking about the Constitution here. SAUs are a statutory construction from the 1920s to improve the buying power of schools. that's where the SAU comes from. Because if you consolidate the administration of the schools and the purchasing, the how many things you're going to buy at one time, you get a better break on the cost. That's where SAUs come from.
That was the justification.
In 1920s. That's where they date from. It then goes on, provided notwithstanding that several towns, parishes, bodies, corporate, or religious societies shall at all times have the exclusive right of electing their own public teachers and of contracting with them for their support and maintenance, and no portion of any one particular religious sect or denomination shall ever be compelled to pay toward the support of a teacher of another persuasion or sect or denomination. So what they're saying is, if you're a Baptist, you can't be compelled to pay for the Methodist school. That's fine. Which means you don't have to send your kids there, but if that's where you're gonna send your kids, you're gonna have to pay for it. The important thing to, now, if we look at this, let's see, go over to, I think it's about page 4. Unfortunately, it is not in color, although it is kind of ghosted out. Because the way this article was amended starts right here. You'll see the bottom of the page. They basically amended the article by just striking things out. They changed evangelical principles to high principles, which of course has no particular meaning, which is problematic.
You're talking in 1784?
No, this is in 1968. So in 1968, we changed evangelical to high. So now what's going to save us are not something specific, evangelical principles, but high principles. What these high principles are, nobody knows. We then go on and we strike out public instruction of worship of the deity. You know, and you can just see it's basically redlined out. And unfortunately, you get, in the end, what we now have is morality and piety, rightly grounded on high principles, will give the best and greatest security to government and lay in the hearts of men the strongest obligations to due subjection. Okay. And as knowledge of these is most likely propagated through a society, therefore, the several parishes, corporate or religious societies shall at all times have the right of electing their own teachers. Ponder that for a minute. Therefore, tells you there's a dependent clause. How is there any connection with, as knowledge of these is most likely to be propagated through a society, therefore these entities have the power of contracting their own teachers? You end up with a garbage sentence because nobody actually cared what they were creating in 1968. They only cared about what they were striking out. What their objective was to strike out evangelical and deity. They had absolutely no concern for actually creating an article that said something. The grammar is abysmal.
And there weren't any other changes any place else that affected the schools?
The only thing that's, the only other principal change is that prior to that, the several towns, parishes, bodies, corporate, religious, had the exclusive right of electing their own teachers and of contracting for them for their support. And that exclusive power was struck out as well, which it authorizes the state government and apparently the federal government to come in and start stirring the waters with their fingers.
But none of the other articles did the thing.
No, the only other article that touches on the subject is Article 83, which was amended in 1873, adding that you couldn't be compelled to pay for a seminary or school of another denomination. That's known as the Blaine Amendment, and it was passed in a number of states at the time, and it was really targeted at making sure that public money didn't go to Catholic seminaries. That was the purpose. And that was a concerted effort in the 1870s.
So the June 2nd, 1784, that verbiage was exactly what you have italicized below.
Yes.
This was as it was written, and it had to go through ratification. And so June 2nd, that was the ratified language.
Correct.
So you went from this to this.
You went from something that actually said something to something that says nothing. In part because of ignorance, in part because the motivation at the time was to drive religion out of the public world. And there are things you could have done. I mean, I've proposed amendments to the current version of Part 1, Article 6, that instead of saying high principles, said fundamental principles of the Constitution. Made the dependent clause into something that said, in order to teach these principles, we have public schools.
You know, is there anything in any of the articles that say you have to have public schools?
No.
It just describes, prescribes how they have to be, but it doesn't say you have to have
Well, what originally had, which is also struck out, which actually means the legislature has no authority to do anything in this regard. Originally it said that the legislature, that in order to have these schools of public instruction, we authorize the legislature to create them. Or we authorize the legislature to authorize them. The text regarding the legislature is struck. So actually, all our schools are now, and our therefore our school districts are operating without legislative authority. The legislature has no power to create school districts.
But we always have, like our town, we have two towns. One is for schools, which is most of the budget, and one is for everything else.
Well, what you have is, you have to understand, well, this is a great discussion, actually. The legislature, a town is a municipal corporation, okay? If you look at the definition of corporation, it is a body politic is the definition of corporation. So Part 2, Article 1 of our Constitution creates the corporation, the fundamental corporation, known as the State of New Hampshire. Create the body politic, the State of New Hampshire. You then have other types of corporations, and that corporation, the reason, and our statutes have always recognized churches as fundamental corporations. Churches, by virtue of existence, are corporations. The reason you have a corporation is for sovereign immunity, and so that the body can own property. Okay? Once you have, and we'll use the example of a church because it's easy. Okay, you have a church, you build a building. Who owns the building? Well, it's that corporation of believers that owns the church. And because it's a corporation, none of the members can be held individually liable for somebody tripping on the steps going out. In the same way, Part 2, Article 1 creates the corporation, the State of New Hampshire, so that we can own a state house. So that if somebody trips on the front steps of the state house, they can't sue you individually. They can sue the state.
It's called
sovereign immunity, and it originates because originally countries or nations were owned by essentially by the king, and so the sovereign was immune. We then get into the practice, we have municipal corporations. Well, in New Hampshire, the state creates a municipal corporation, and that is now a political subdivision of the state, or a county, and recognizes that it's like a division of a corporate, you know, a for-profit corporation. Okay, but it is part of the state, just like the McDonald's on Main Street is part of McDonald's corporate. Okay, they're created under the authority of McDonald's. That's how we usually think of franchise. The legal term is franchise. It's the ability to do business in a manner not available to the general public is the definition. We create municipal corporations. The state also creates corporations for people doing commercial business. In essence, any incorporated entity, the ones that say Inc. or LLC or PPA or PPC or whatever moniker they have, is a political subdivision of the state. The state tells them what their form of government must be. The state tells them that they have to give them an annual report of all their activity during the last year. The state can dissolve the corporation at any time. When they go into business, they have to tell the state, we're going to do this scope of business, and you can't change that scope of business without permission from the state. Until the 1960s, all corporations were created by the legislature. I have the act of incorporation in the legislature for PSNH. In the 1960s, we delegated that to the Secretary of State as a ministerial function. But it is still, in effect, a legislative act because we told the Secretary of State he could just do it now. He, our current Secretary of State, understands the sanctity of his operation and refuses to make rules for the creation of the corporations. People keep trying to, you know, like all the departments create rules. He refuses to create rules. He says, that's the job of the legislature, thank you, I don't create rules.
So all the towns and cities and all were corporations created by the state?
Correct.
And school districts were also created separately by the state?
Right, so what you have with a school district in a town, you have two overlapping municipal corporations. Independent, but with the same geographic description. Or sometimes you have cooperative school districts that may overlay several school districts and several municipal towns.
Why wouldn't the school thing just be part of the town?
It was until the 1960s.
And why would it change?
Because, for one thing, we changed Article 6, so, I mean, because we thought it was a better way to do it.
I mean, in our town, which is, I suspect, fairly consistent with others, the school spent 80% of the money.
Absolutely, that's 80-90%.
And 10 people come to that meeting, and the other 20% of the money is 200 people.
Yep.
What do you? What town do you?
So.
Most people don't get that kind of participation in the town meeting.
Well, I guess it sounds ridiculous. I mean, I have to say
I
don't disagree.
I don't disagree. But yeah. It is part of our problem today is most people do not understand how our government is constructed.
Well, that's why we're here. That's
right. I mean, that's
on my mind. Okay.
And the reason I learned about corporations and franchises is I was looking at Part 2, Article 6, which is the authority to tax. And it states, and until 1903. It stated that we had, look at Part 1.
But what I was getting
Well, no, but this is important. Okay, the public charges of government, or any part thereof, may be raised by taxation upon poles, that's a head tax, estates, and this is the 1901-1903 amendment, and other classes of property, including franchises and property when passing by will or inheritance.
Well, but the legislature then could change, for example, our town, they could allow us to have one cooperative, which is all. Are there any towns like that?
Not to the best of my knowledge. It's been the practice for the 20th century to have a school district independent of the town. A separate municipal corporation.
Is that the teachers union that's pushing that?
I have no idea.
Well, it's nothing. In other words, let's say that my town, through its representatives or whatever, went in and asked the legislature to make one entity rather than two. They could, if they convinced the legislature to do it.
There's nothing stopping them. Oh, well, I guess actually now that Article 6 no longer gives the legislature authority over education, technically it's problematic, but most people aren't astute enough to realize their limitations. The original thing said that we hereby authorize the legislature, okay, the people may and of a right I'm sorry, I'm looking at the amended version. There we go. The people of this state have the right to empower and do hereby fully empower the legislature to authorize from time to time the several towns, parishes, bodies, corporate, or religious societies within this state to make adequate provision for education. That's been struck. The legislature no longer has that authority.
Who does?
Technically, nobody. That's what happens when the way they amended it, they amended it by just doing a red line, having no care for what they were actually saying. And you can tell that both by what they took out and what the grammar looks like.
So if somebody were to start a thing in the legislature, try to get, let's say started, to have one corporation rather than two, there's no obvious way to get it done, but there's no obvious impediment either.
I'm sure nobody would object to it on constitutional grounds. I have attempted to get the legislature's authority reinstated, and that failed. Because, in part because they don't recognize, I can't remember, Eugene Van Loan, that's who it is. He's one of the top high-powered attorneys in the state, and he is of the opinion that Article 6 doesn't pertain to town schools because it doesn't say so, but the original version did say towns. So he would say that has only to do, he would argue against, you know, he's not in the legislature, but he would testify before the legislature that Article 6 doesn't pertain to public schools.
But the legislature, for example, could eliminate two corporations, school and the rest of the town, and started, and then you're back in with one.
Yes.
So this originally was basically a political thing. This is yes. Not a legal. Okay.
No.
But did it say they had to be separate? It just said that they...
No, it did not say they had to be separate.
Yeah.
It said the towns were authorized to create the schools.
Create schools could be part of their own entity, like a fire department.
Absolutely. That's what they were. Originally.
I don't know how far off we're drifting here, but with the amendment to Article 6, does the legislature have the right to say to start it that they can do this or do that? They don't have the authority to say that.
Except that the municipal corporation is authorized for certain purposes. And probably education is not one of them. So Stoddard can't just go do it. They would have to seek permission from the state to change to one entity.
Because of their original charter.
Well, because of what the charter is now.
Because it's not home rule.
Right. We don't have home rule. We never were a home rule state. The power of making laws we saw in Article 29 is very particularly given to the legislature or authority derived therefrom. A lot of people would like to say that extends to the departments, but I would argue that would not be the case. First of all, if you look back to Locke, Locke says we have the authority to make laws, not to make legislators. I mean, that's the non-delegation doctrine. That's right there. But on top of that, it does say authority derived therefrom. If you go back to the founding period, what did they have? They had the subordinate legislatures of the towns created by the legislature. They had the subordinate legislatures of the counties, which are in fact the elected state representatives from that county, and are authorized by the legislature. That's authorized by the legislature. What you don't have until we did not have any executive departments who would even conceived of making rules until the 1830s. The first department being Fish and Game. It was the first executive department. So there's no way you could construe that in 1784, when they wrote authority derived therefrom, would have extended to a department, because that wasn't even in their gray matter. They wouldn't have been thinking to authorize departments to do that, because departments didn't exist.
Well, but the town, if it's two, if it's a corporation or two corporations, for example, for starter, the school part, for example, doesn't have to belong to SAU.
Well, statutorily it does, but literally no.
What statute?
The statute that deals with SAUs, which says every school has to be part of an SAU, even if that SAU includes only one school, and we have a number of those now.
Every government school or every school?
Every government school. It does not pertain to private schools.
They have to have an SAU above the school itself.
According to state law right now.
So a town could say, I'm going to create my own SAU with all of you.
Well, a lot of towns have collapsed into one SAU. Fremont, well, I guess it's K now. K through 8, Fremont School District is its own SAU.
But there's nothing stopping my town, for example.
Well, SAUs are created by the legislature.
Okay, so there is something standing.
Right. So, well, it's another corporation. It's another corporation.
So I would have to go, we would have to go to the legislature to create another corporation, eliminate something else. And
yes. Yeah, all
and
these things.
We still have to have an SAU.
All of these things are political subdivisions of the state, or you could petition the state to get rid of your SAU and you just have a school district. I mean, SAUs made sense when you had, you know, 20 kids in this school and 30 kids in this school, and by ganging a bunch of schools together, you had one authority doing all the payroll and doing all the buying of pencils and paper. Okay? So you take.
I understand it's a political okay. thing.
Well, no, it wasn't just a political thing. It was an economy thing. It was an economy of scale thing. We take these 10, 50 student districts, we make them into one SAU, and that SAU does all the buying and administrative stuff for these 10 schools, and we get the economies of scale. But when you now have, when those 10-50 student schools have become 10-500 student schools, you no longer have economies of scale.
So in that acronym, SAU, what's that mean?
School Administrative Unit. So it is a separate corporation that had a function in the first two-thirds of the 20th century, but it's now kind of redundant because of population growth.
I mean, the reason I'm asking is I've asked a lot of other people about it, and they say, well, you have to have it, and I don't understand.
By law, you have to have it.
I understand, but what you're saying is politically we could change it.
Yes, of course. Okay. It's only a law. You just have to convince 200 people to change it, or 201.
Or there's always secession.
Questionable on the town level in New Hampshire.
Got to have permission to secede.
Yeah, I mean, you really would, because unlike, for instance, Massachusetts is a commonwealth, which is an aggregate of sovereign municipalities. New Hampshire is a state divided into towns, which exist under the authority of the state.
But
we chose that, we specifically and intentionally chose that for uniformity of law. So that unlike Massachusetts, where you can be driving, you can be in one town and you're doing something that's legal, you cross the border into the next town and all of a sudden it's not legal. Our exchange for that was to have a large legislature to ensure that every town was represented.
But we never would have gotten permission from King George to secede, and it's analogous to requiring permission for jury nullification.
Yeah, it is. You have to choose your battles.
Yeah, that's no doubt.
Of course, there isn't a militia right now, so you'd have a leg up.
There's another discussion.
I know. We'll get there. That's Article 26.
I expect it.
Being a strong proponent of the militia. So, are there any further discussion of Article 6?
You've confused us enough with this. You better move on.
Article 11. is great. It's something, well, the first, again, you have to go back, and it's not obvious. The first, originally it ended right where, let's see, it went down to where you had, I think, period after domicile, and then picked up the last sentence. And everything else in between has been progressively, which is probably both an accurate representation of events and a political statement at the same time. But it's been progressively added over the centuries. And if you look at it, it's been amended a lot of times over the 20th century.
Did we play it on 5 and 6?
Yeah.
Did we hit anything that was important that we missed?
No, I don't think so. We really we messed it up. It's basically what we did with Article 6.
For example, has it been used in court cases? There was this funding case up there.
No, that was
not. Nothing to do with
Article 6. No, that was all based on Article 83.
So nothing in here precludes our laws funding of a religious school.
Well, no, because now.
In here.
Well, it hasn't been used. The language is equally effective, but it has not been used.
Okay, that's all. We can move on to.
Okay. So, and there's been a lot of changes to Article 6, I mean Article 11. Interesting, and they don't talk about it, but in 1903 we amended Article 6 to provide that you had to be able to read the English language and write the English language in order to vote. That's been taken out. We did add that if you were convicted of treason, bribery, or willful violation of the election laws, that you would lose the right to vote. And that is still in effect.
You don't have to be able to speak English in order to vote.
No, we amended that out in...
Are we providing ballots in non-English?
Not to the best of my knowledge. It does make it hard.
Yeah.
Does complicate the situation. But no, I do not believe we provide alternative language.
But in order to be a citizen, you have to be able to speak English, right?
I don't know.
Is that not a requirement?
I don't know. I would be an unreliable testator to say yay or nay on that.
When I became a citizen, they tested me on English. Sure I can speak. So,
when was that?
That was 7 years ago.
Okay.
Then it probably is still in effect.
Yeah, probably hasn't changed since then.
When Mark became a citizen, he had to demonstrate the ability to read and write English. Right. Of course, if you go back to Massachusetts at the time of the founding, not only did you have to read and write English, you had to be able to read the Constitution of the state of Massachusetts and in English and comprehend it.
Current U.S. government can't comprehend.
Well, no, it was a Massachusetts Constitution.
Well, I'm not so sure about them either.
One of the most important things in Article 11, two things. One is the use of the word domicile. Every person shall be considered an inhabitant for the purposes of voting in the town, ward, or unincorporated place where he has his domicile. Over the years, we have confused residency with domicile. Domicile means a permanent residence. You can be a resident of more than one location. Okay, if I have my domicile in Fremont, and I have a lake house up on Winnipesaukee, when I am up in Winnipesaukee, I am a resident there. I am residing there. But I am still domiciled in Fremont. And that's an important. That has been actually messed up by the federal Supreme Court. They have given residency a higher status than domicile. Domicile is actually the higher status term.
Do
traditionally. The other thing that's important is that, in the last sentence, that every inhabitant of the state having the proper qualification has an equal right to be elected to office. And that actually came to play several times during the term 2011-2012, when I was chairman of the Constitutional Review Committee. Because not the Constitution makes a statement there that everybody having the qualifications has the right to be elected. Then in the end of the form of government, we list a number of disqualifications. Conflicting offices, holding a federal office of some sort, are all things that disqualify you from being elected to certain offices. So the principle being that if you are going to have a disqualification for office, it's got to be in the Constitution. The legislature can't just make it up on the fly. And we had a number of well-intended bills, Republican bills, intended to get rid of conflict of interest. That you couldn't be a paid advocate of a political party and hold, you know, be a legislator. There are a number of bills like that, which I have to say to my good Republican friends, sorry, no. Constitution says everybody has a right to be elected to office except these several in Articles 95 and 96, I think, in Part 2. We have some probably unconstitutional laws on the books because it says that a county attorney has to be a member of the bar to be elected. But that's not in the Constitution. That's only a matter of statute. And if every member of the community has an equal right to be elected to office, it doesn't match. It's one of the reasons I think that the towns have drifted away from electing their police chiefs. Because if it's an appointed chief, you can require that they be, you know, have gone to the Police Standards and Trainings Academy and be indoctrinated. If they're an elected police chief, you can't make that requirement.
Don't get me started on where.
Where?
Oh boy.
Article 12 is another one of those wonderfully logical articles. Every member of the community, it's only been amended once. It was amended in 1964 to strike out something that people didn't really understand, unfortunately. Every member of the community has a right to be protected by it in the enjoyment of his life, liberty, and property. He is therefore obligated to pay his share of the expense for such protection and to yield his personal service when necessary, which refers to being in the militia and jury duty. But no part of a man's property shall be taken from him or applied to public use without his consent or that of the representative body of the people, the legislature. Nor are the inhabitants of this state controllable by any laws other than those to which they, town meeting, or their representative body have given their consent. So we've had a number of problematic things come through the legislature where we say our building codes are going to be the international building codes. That means that if they change the international building codes, our building codes change without so much as a by-year leave and no control. So it's a very dangerous step to take. But there's an important principle here. If you can tie, every member has the right of the community has a right to be protected by it, the community, in the enjoyment of their life, liberty, and property, which ties you right back to your natural rights in Article 2. And if you look at all of our forms of taxation in New Hampshire, we tax property. We tax or we taxed polls originally. Actually, there are still some towns that rely on a poll tax, so it doesn't generate a whole lot. But if you are alive and you pay the poll tax, that is, there's proof positive that the government has done its job of protecting your life. If you have been able to acquire property, there is proof positive that is that the community has done its right in protecting your enjoyment of your property. Right? So you have our taxation is connected to our natural rights and is connected to things that are evident, if you will, from the street, as opposed to an income tax where they have to go into your private affairs. It's a very important principle. I'm going to drift here, but remember back in Article 6, it says the public charges of government may be charged to polls and taxes on estates. You notice, and then they extended that to franchises, which is ownership of a corporation, and property when passed by will or inheritance, which is a transfer. And in that debate in the convention, they said, and everybody knows this does not pertain to personal income, right? And they all agreed, because they had a very good understanding of the difference between income and property. And they said, because income isn't property. Anybody deal with accounting at all?
I'm not allowed to touch a checkbook.
Well, if you look, and that's why we have you voting on the budget, right? If you look at accounting, you have the profit and loss sheet, which deals with income, and you have the balance sheet that deals with property. Income is a transfer of property. It is defined as gain on property or labor. But if it is a gain on property, it is not property. The only transfer that we are authorized to tax in New Hampshire is when passed by will or inheritance. Which brings us to the sales tax. Sales tax is only valid, constitutional, if it is in fact a franchise tax, a tax on the franchises, the room and meals tax. The business and enterprise tax and business profits tax are only valid if they are franchise taxes, not some form of income tax. Well, if they are valid, if they are in fact franchise taxes, can they be assessed on businesses that are not franchised? I have a sole proprietorship, Christofferson Engineering. I have to turn in forms for the business enterprise and business profits tax. Now, I don't make the threshold to have to pay anything, but I have to turn in the forms. But I have been trying to get proprietorships off of the list of entities that are taxed under the business enterprise and business profits tax, because I'm not gaining the benefits of being franchised. I don't have sovereign immunity. If I screw up, my house is forfeit.
I thought you didn't have to file if you were under the pressure.
No, you have to file. You do not have to pay.
So you still have to file with the state?
Yes.
So I understand the difference between a profit loss sheet and a balance sheet, but I'm not sure I understand why you can go after property but not income. You don't have me quite there yet.
Because income isn't property until it's in your bank account. If you wanted to in effect charge tax people for income, there is a way you could do it. Every year, there is, if you compare your property at the beginning of the year, your property at the end of the year, you have what's called a change in financial position. That is by definition equal to your net income. But it's a state, it's a tax, it is a property issue, not an income issue. You could tax people for a change in financial position, which is an increase in their property. It's in effect visible from the street. And you decide what you want to include, house, cars, maybe certain bank accounts, but something that is basically public information, ownership of franchise, you know, your stock portfolio. Those would all be legitimate. Your change in value of those holdings would be a legitimate target of taxation in New Hampshire. But income itself is not.
So if I, and the reason is because the property is something that the state is protecting.
Yes.
Therefore, because the state is protecting the property, it's subject to being taxed. But if I make $100,000 and I buy nothing but Mercury beer with that $100,000 and it's all gone, then the state is no longer protecting the Mercury's beer because I drank it all.
Correct.
But if I instead bought a nice big boat, that boat requires
if we chose to do a some sort of a luxury tax, but it would have actually some interesting byproducts if you were taxing change in financial position. What happens if you lose your job and you start living off your assets? Your financial position, your change in financial position becomes negative. No taxes. What happens if you get into retirement and you're now living off your assets and they aren't so much that your gain every year is greater than your expenses? It has some interesting attributes, but it requires an understanding of what we as a legislature are authorized to do. Income, and they said this in the convention, income is not property. We all know that. And they all knew that.
That's what happens, you get a bunch of lawyers together.
I mean, that's part of the beauty of when you do things by convention is by at least to some degree, the people making the changes to the rules for making the laws are not the people making the laws. So you have a degree of independence and throttle upon the legislature. That's the importance of a convention, as opposed to having all your amendments come out of the legislature. Then you have the people trying to protect the power you delegated to them. Are they going to give you back any of the power you delegated to them? Not likely. Of course, I don't trust government.
Realist.
That was one of the fundamental principles of our founding period, is they didn't trust government. That's why we have constitutions. We have a great amendment to Article 12, Article 12A, that was actually brought in 2006 by Bob Guida, who's now running for Senate up in the North Country. If you remember back in 2005-ish, we had, I can't remember the name of it now, down in Connecticut, where they took property and it was appealed to the federal Supreme Court, and our judge from New Hampshire was the decider.
Fort Trumbull.
Yep.
Kelo decision.
Kelo decision, thank you very much. And it created a national uproar. Well, based on that, Bob proposed this amendment, which says that if you take property by eminent domain, it can be only be used for a public purpose.
Did it pass?
Yes, people adopted it overwhelmingly. I think it requires 2/3 to pass, and I think it got 75%, which is a lot. I mean, usually constitutional amendments are squeakers, and it was a relative landslide. There was nobody who wanted to admit to wanting to let the government just take money from one person and give it to another. And we actually had, we actually amended the laws. That's one of the funny things. You hear all this stuff about Northern Pass and the hoopla about eminent domain, and there is no eminent domain transaction in Northern Pass. In fact, myself and Brandon Guida, Bob's brother, who was in the legislature in 11 and 12, we sat in on a special meeting of the Science, Technology, and Energy Committee, and we amended the laws to make it clear that you could only take land for power transmission lines if the grid was in danger or we were in danger of being kicked out of the grid. So you had to have a compelling public interest to take land for power transmission lines. And as a result, there is no eminent domain being used for Northern Pass.
It's something we're talking about.
And they talk about it, but no. Can't happen. We changed the law based on Bob's 2006 amendment. We can't take money, we can't take people's land and give it to PSNH. PSNH
has
to.
Have you ever thought about talking to the press to get these reporters that have a little understanding what the hell they're talking about?
In honesty, no.
It
just hadn't crossed my radar screen. Oh, now here's one. This was an amendment to Article 12. I think I may have only been an amendment to Article 13. Article 13, no person who is conscientiously scrupulous about the lawfulness of bearing arms shall be compelled thereto. That's pretty straightforward.
Did that read that one again?
No person who is conscientiously scrupulous about the lawfulness of bearing arms shall be compelled thereto. So if you're a conscientious objector, you don't have to be in the militia. That's what it basically said.
Originally, the right of conscience.
Right. Originally, there was a caveat to that, that you still had to pay to support the militia, because even if you didn't want to take arms, they were still protecting your property. That has to do with the organization of the militia, in that originally, in the founding period, and it wasn't true that we last had a state guard in the 1950s, but in the founding period, if you didn't have your own firearms, for one, you know, you were unable to purchase them for because you didn't have enough money, the town supplied your arms. And then you progressively bought it back over time. And so the town, that was where, you know, so if you were a widow and therefore you didn't have anybody in your household to be a member of the state guard or the militia, or if you were a conscientious objector and you didn't want, felt you could not be a member of the militia, you still had to pay toward the town fund that bought the common powder, the common shot, and firearms for those who could not afford them. It was removed in 1968 as a reference to buying one's way out of military service, which is not what it was. It was not buying your way out. It was saying, I'm a Quaker. I'm a conscientious objector. Therefore, I can't take up arms and shoot another person. But you were still compelled to support those who were going to protect your property. And that was seen as buying one's way out of military service and was struck. But
they couldn't like just compel them to be medics in the militia.
Well, they didn't really have medics at that time. You had the doctors, but they were members of the militia. Doctors were actually exempt from being members of the militia. You had exempt professions, and so a doctor didn't have to be a member of the training band. If you were in an exempt profession, you did not have to be in the training band, the first order, the guys who were called out to the battlefield, potentially. You had to be a member of the alarm list, which was when the enemy were at the gates.
But this only applies to state militia, not if there's an national draft.
That there is no such thing as anything other than a state militia.
Right, but the federal army.
Right.
It would not apply to that.
No, doesn't, it has nothing to do with the federal army. Article 14, another one that's probably not met too often. Every subject of this state is entitled to certain remedy having recourse to the laws for all injuries he may receive in his person, property, or character to obtain right and justice freely without being obliged to purchase it completely and without any denial, promptly, without delay, conformably to the laws. So, is it proper to have court fees? This says you can't have to pay to get into court. Now, the court actually does waive court fees if you can demonstrate that you don't have the means to pay them. But, which I suppose is their way around it. But it is...
The lawyers have blown that out of the water.
But, again, what was the first purpose of the state? Why does the state exist?
Justice.
To provide justice. To punish injustice. That's one of another famous political theorist from the 1800s, actually, Bastiat, said that justice does not exist in the positive. It exists only in the positive. You can't create justice. What you can do is punish injustice. And that's one of our failings, actually, in our society today, is we have this belief that we can create justice. Part of it comes from a confusion in what justice really is. We have two concepts, really. Justice and equality. Justice is when somebody who has wronged you is punished or compelled to make reparation for what they did in some way. You know, a medical malpractice, the doctor or the doctor's insurance company is compelled to repay you for the damage. You have another concept, equality. And inequality, I dare say, is the human condition. Some people are smart, some people are not. Some people are tall, some people are short. Some people have trees fall in their houses. Some people have hail hit their cars. Inequality is the human condition. And historically, we always allowed God to deal with inequality, either in this life or the next. When you take God out of the equation and you see inequality, then you feel compelled to address it. And you begin to treat inequality as though it were injustice. The problem is, government being what it is, government must treat everyone equally. So once you begin to treat inequality as though it were injustice, you have to alleviate everyone's inequality completely. Or you're not treating everybody equally.
But there's the distinction between equality of opportunity and the equality of outcome.
We don't make that distinction. And even inequality of opportunity. If somebody is born without legs, how do you give them equal opportunity to run a race? You can't. You just can't.
I'm not gonna, right.
So one has to accept government in its limitations. Once you begin to address inequality as though it were injustice, you create a financial obligation that is impossible to satisfy. Well, if you don't solve it completely, you haven't met your obligation. This is just a little aside. injustice and inequality.
We all know that men are stronger than women.
Some of them.
Well, on average. On average. But there are certain physiological certainties. Men have more upper body strength, more shoulder strength.
And have bigger brains, too.
Do you realize you're sitting between two women? You're in a bad place right now.
But seriously,
men have more upper body strength. That is physiology. You can't make that equal. It is what it is.
But the opportunity, the opportunity is what it is. It's a matter of whether you're putting roadblocks in front of that opportunity.
That's
government is the only one with monopoly on force to be able to do that.
True. And the government should not be putting impediments.
Exactly.
And that's an issue of what government is not allowed to do as opposed to what government is required to do.
Absolutely.
Positive rights versus negative rights.
Absolutely.
With Article 15, we start to get into a lot of the mechanics of government, how government actually deals with the people. We had taxation in Article 12. The Articles 1 through 10 really lay groundwork. Article 11 is franchise, voting franchise. Article 12 is taxation. We get to Article 15, we have the rights of the accused. And we have no subject to be, this is where we get no subject shall be held to answer to any crime or offense until the same is fully and substantially explained to them. So you can't be brought to court unless you are actually charged with something by the government. The article, your Article 15 rights, it's called rights of the accused, but remember, it's Article 15. It really does now have a title because it was amended in 66 and 84. But prior to that, it did not truly have a title. So don't let rights of the accused limit your understanding of what the article is saying to you. It deals with how when the government has a case against a person or persons, the limitations on their ability to get into their private lives, to broach their rights of privacy. It is, it's our right to trial by jury for in criminal cases. It is required that you have to have a warrant for arrest or search or seizure. And that warrant has to be very specific. You look at the federal constitution and the issues of warrant are very general. It just says there has to be a warrant. In our constitution, let's see. If I can find it here. I'm sorry, that's Article 19. This deals with being subject to the law. That you have to, okay, no subject will be held to answer for any crime unless the same is fully, plainly, and substantially and formally described to him or be compelled to accuse or furnish evidence against himself. Every subject has the right to produce all proofs that may be favorable to himself. To meet the witnesses against him face to face, to be fully heard in his defense by himself and counsel. No subject shall be arrested, imprisoned, despoiled, or deprived of his property, immunities or privileges, put out of the public protection of the law, exiled or deprived of his life, liberty, or estate, but by a judgment of his peers or the law of the land. And then we get into the amendments. That's where it originally stopped. Then we get into, you have the right to a public defender, which is a 1964 law. We also get into the issues of deemed criminally insane. That's criminally insane is 1964, I believe. No, 1964, and as is the right to counsel. And in 1984, we added the obligation of the state to pay for counsel if necessary. But you think about everything that lines out there, those kinds of protections aren't part of the federal constitution. These are the obligations that our local law enforcement, our local judiciary, are accountable to. And it's a much higher standard. That's important. Everybody talks about, you know, their Fourth Amendment rights when they get apprehended by the police. That's not what you got to be worried about. In New Hampshire, you have to be worried about your Article 15 and Article 17 rights. They're far more extensive, and they are what our local law enforcement, state and town, are actually obligated to. I am going to jump, right over to 17. In criminal prosecutions, the trial of facts, Article 19 rather, every subject has a right to be secure from all unreasonable searches and seizures in his person, house, and paper, and his papers, and all his possessions. Therefore, all warrants to search suspected places or arrest a person for examination or trial in prosecutions for criminal matters are contrary to this right, if the cause or foundation of them be not previously supported by oath or affirmation, and the order in a warrant to a civil officer made to search suspected places or to arrest one or more suspected persons or to seize property be not accompanied. So they have to list what they're going to search for instance, when they enter your house. And I've actually seen this exercise in New Hampshire, where they went in to search for one form of drug. And they went in and they seized that, but they also saw, I think, mushrooms. And they didn't seize those because they were not part of the warrant.
Is that kind of specificity required?
Yes. By our Constitution, yes. Is it necessarily enforced? I don't know. But it certainly exists that what is going to be searched for and what is going to be seized has to be enumerated in the warrant.
But illicit drug, arbitrarily illicit drug, is not specific enough?
Well, I would suppose it would depend on, I know in that case, I think the warrant was written for marijuana.
But did they have to write it that specifically?
That's probably why.
Yeah, let the judges figure it out, sure.
I know traditionally it has been. Now, whether they're still practicing that or not, I don't know. But traditionally it was that. I mean, that was 10 years ago, that case that I read about. So it isn't like it's 100 years ago or 20 years ago. It's in recent memory. Now, statutorily, the interesting thing is statutorily, we have given a number of individuals the power to search without warrant, including inspectors for weights and scales.
What?
Weights and measures.
Weights and measures, yeah. So they can go in and seize a scale without a warrant. And we've done that statutorily. Obviously, that's wrong. Although one of the ways we get around such things is to call something a civil offense rather than a criminal offense. And when you call something civil, then all your criminal protections go out the window.
But shouldn't a civil offense really, they both should, but shouldn't a civil offense have an actual victim? Somebody complaining?
In that case, you could argue that anybody who got improperly weighed was so offended.
But was there a complaint?
Don't know.
And shouldn't that be in civil court?
No, that's part of the business license.
So on the amendments, where are the amendments? Or like on Article 17, change assembly to the legislature. Is that it? Is that the complete amendment? Shall we change?
I would have to look and read through. I don't know particularly in. Article 17 or Article 19? Okay. Yeah, they changed assembly to legislature in 1792. And you can pretty much trust any amendment that was made in that period. Although in 1978, in Article 17, we changed it so that the... Article 17 is venue for criminal prosecutions, which is actually important. We talked about this a little bit in the first class, where in Article 17 specifically gives jurisdiction of criminal prosecutions to the judiciary. Okay, because it reads, in criminal prosecutions, the trial of facts in the vicinity of where it happened is so essential to the security and life and liberty in the state of the citizens that no crime or offense ought to be tried in any other county or judicial district than in which it was committed, except in the case that any particular county or judicial district, and that's the amendment, upon motion by the defendant and after a finding by the court that a fair and impartial trial cannot be had where the offense be committed, the court shall direct the trial to a county or judicial district in which a fair and impartial trial can be obtained. That whole last bit there about changing venue, that's the amendment at the defendant's request. But that very clearly gives the venue of criminal action to the judiciary. Article 20, which we haven't gotten to yet and is worthy of its own discussion, but by referencing a jury for civil trials, clearly gives jurisdiction for civil controversies between two or more persons to the judiciary. But if you remember, in Article 32, the jurisdiction over crimes of the state against an individual are given to the legislature. I don't know what time it is. It's 8 o'clock.
Yeah, I don't want to rush you because I love these things. Okay, and I just want to be sure. Be sure that my bride is on your mailing list. I don't want to miss one.
I appreciate that. Well, the only thing we haven't looked at Article 18, which is actually a really cool one, but it has little real functional power. We haven't looked at Article 16. Which has, which deals with double jeopardy and jury trial for capital cases. It's pretty vanilla, so we can cover that one real quick. It's never changed either. No subject shall be liable to be tried after an acquittal for the same crime or offense, nor shall the legislature make any law subject any person to capital punishment except for the government of the Army and the Navy and the militia in actual service without trial by jury. So you can only suffer capital punishment in this state if you're a member of the military without a trial by jury. Everything else must be by trial by jury. It's pretty straightforward. It's a basic principle of American and British justice. But I would like to, because I think it really rounds us out, and Article 20 is a long discussion in and of itself. But Article 18, all penalties ought to be proportional to the nature of the offense. No wise legislature will affix the same punishment to the crimes of theft, forgery, and the like, which they do to those of murder and treason, where the same undistinguishing severity is exerted against all offenses. The people are led to forget the real distinction in the crime themselves and to commit the most flagrant with as little compunction as they do the lightest offenses. For the same reason, a multitude of sanguinary, everybody know what sanguinary means?
Bloody.
Sanguinary laws is both impolitic and unjust. The true design of all punishment being to reform and not to exterminate mankind. Now here's a great question. You got that last one there. The true design of punishment being to reform and not to exterminate mankind. Now some of my brethren on the other side of the aisle have tried to use that to say that we shouldn't have capital punishment. Is that a valid interpretation of that line?
Lawyers can argue either side.
You say no.
No, I'm just saying the lawyer will argue either side.
Well, but what? Okay, why? So is that a valid argument that line says we can't have capital punishment in New Hampshire?
No.
No. Why not? What other article have we just gone over that would tell you no?
Something about 16.
16, which authorizes capital punishment.
Punishment fits the crime.
Right, but we also have Article 16, which discusses capital punishment. Therefore, you cannot use Article 18 to say we can't have it. Now, we may make a legislative decision that we shouldn't. That's entirely different. But you cannot use Article 18 to say that capital punishment is wrong, because in Article 16 we discussed that you can't have capital punishment without a jury trial. Remember, it's one indissoluble fabric of unity and amity. But it's a problem we really have in this state right now, where we have sanguinary laws. I'll give you a personal example. I'm a licensed engineer. Now, in addition to having my license, which costs me $150 every 2 years, and I have to do 30 hours of educational time, which costs me something as well, if only for the lost income. On top of that, my business, Christofferson Engineering, has to have a business license, which costs me, I think, $80 every year. Now, maybe it's $100 now, it goes up fairly regularly. If I forget to pay my business license by December 31st, and in January I do some engineering. Now, I still have my personal license, because that renews in May every 2 years. I haven't injured anybody. Nobody's complained or said that I did them wrong. All I did was do some engineering. What level of crime do you think it is for me to do engineering without my corporation license?
In other words, who have you offended?
Well, but what level of crime is it? What is the penalty for doing engineering with my private license but not with my corporate license? But without my corporate license?
Well, you said your bill's in personally
without the corporate. It's a felony. For failure to pay an annual $80 fee.
For offending the state, not to put too fine a point on it.
Does that fit with Article 18?
It would not seem to. Proportionate.
It is not proportional. It's 5 years and something like $10,000 potential fine for failure to pay an $80 fee. Because in fact, the business license relies entirely on my private license, my individual license.
Just in terms of offensive person.
I know. But you know, this is, it's really important. I don't know if I discussed it in this class, but we increased the age to which individuals have to wear life jackets from 5 to 12 back in 2008, I think. And one of the things in the discussion, you know, I did my research on this, because for some reason went to children and family law. And you know, anybody care to guess how many children we've ever had die, drown, because they had fallen off a boat and not had a life jacket on? No, that's an overestimate. We've only had one juvenile drown as a boating accident, and it was unclear because she was in the vicinity of a dock as to whether she actually fell off a boat or not. And she was 3 years old, so she was not in the affected age class. All of the drowning deaths on our watercraft are people generally between the ages of 20 and 30.
Mostly.
Usually with alcohol involved. Now, the bill was written so that if you had anybody under the age of 12 on any boat at any time, in any way, for any purpose, they could only take their life jacket off until they jumped into the water, after they jumped into the water. I brought up the fact that we have a significant tourist industry that people sail from Massachusetts up to Maine on their nice big boats, and they stop in Hampton or Rye or Portsmouth and put in for the night and go ashore and buy dinner and look at gift shops and all the other things that people on boats do. My mother did it. And I pointed out that if you enacted the law in which the way it was presented, that the children would have to wear their life jackets while they were in their bunks sleeping. Because there was no exemption for the boat being at a dock or not moving, no exemption for being in an enclosed cabin. Fortunately, I did get those changes to the law made. But the, what are they called? Marine Patrol individual who was testifying in favor of the bill said, oh, we wouldn't enforce that.
Of course.
Well, what is the point of having a law written in a manner in which you won't enforce it? That's where you start inviting disrespect to the law and inviting people to do this real transgression with this, with the same lack of compunction that they do with the lightest transgression.
And really, shouldn't there be a penalty in the RSA enacted to penalize a department who refuses to enforce a law as written? Hell, they testify that they will refuse, they want you to pass it, but once you pass it, they will not enforce it?
Not as written. They will only enforce it on the bad guys.
Yeah, but they get to decide.
You look like a bad guy.
Yes. Most of them see me that way. Yes. That happens so often, both state and federal. Can we, like tacking on a sunset clause, can there also be some sort of penalty
for failure to enforce?
Exactly. So they have some skin in the game?
We could. Do you think it would ever get past criminal justice?
Hey, if it fails...
It would be a fun discussion to have.
Yes, it would. Yes, indeed it would.
But then don't you get into, okay, so the state did something wrong, so the state has to pay to the state.
Yep, and the
taxes.
But then the taxpayers actually get involved.
No, you make the officer individually liable.
Yes.
You make it a misdemeanor to not enforce the law as written.
Your problem is you...
But I can tell I can just envision the discussion. Because I've had discussions. Well, I had a bill in this last session. How did that go? It would have made it a misdemeanor. Okay, the issue was keeping children out of the home when no abuse or neglect has occurred. And that was not going to be allowed. And the hook on that was that the state would not be allowed to compensate foster parents if there had been no abuse or neglect proved, and if some state doobie approved such a payment, that would be a misdemeanor. Oh, you should have seen
so many disinterested parties.
There was great fireworks and consternation that we could think of holding somebody accountable for having done what they were told to do.
Unless, of course, they didn't work for government.
Right. How can you hold somebody accountable for just following orders?
Say Kyle.
That last comment was made to elucidate the pantomime that went on behind the camera. but that is a serious issue. I mean, that's really what redress of grievances is for. You know, if somebody is injured by the state, actually, you were not at the last one, the videotape one last time. The reason that the jurisdiction of crimes or offenses by the state or its political subdivisions against the individual or individuals was given to the legislature because who has the power to make it right? If there has been a financial injury of some sort, property destroyed or whatever, and money has to come out of the public treasury, who has the power to make, to take, to order money out of the public treasury? Only the legislature. So only we can make that correction. If the, you know, there are some things that happen in divorce, things that are ordered that should never have been ordered. We can't make that right. But there needs to be an amendment to the law so it doesn't happen again. Who can do that? Only the legislature. And that's why redress of grievances is before the legislature and not before the judiciary. Only the legislature can actually correct the problem.
Dan, all you said is it's great fun in the legislature.
I'm
going to my slam games, you know, all the time.
It has gotten better. It's gotten more accountable. I mean, that's one of the things that Paul Mursky did, was just started calling roll calls so that people couldn't hide behind lack of a recorded vote. And you can look up your legislator and see if you want to vote for them again based upon a sundry of scores. The Liberty Alliance does a score. The House Republican Alliance has been doing a score now for 20 years. And you can find out how your legislator votes relative to the Constitution and Republican platform. And if you have a legislator who isn't up to what you consider to be muster, then you can support someone else, or at least not support them. There's a level of accountability that is there now that wasn't there 20 years ago. And the internet has been great, because anybody, even if you don't belong, even if you're not in the legislature and get handed out the report card every so often, you can now go to the website and see what your legislator's voting record is. You can actually look up on any given bill now and access directly what a legislator's voting record is. I have to say, in some regards, there's no excuse. There is no excuse.
There's no excuse for what?
For just voting for somebody because they're on the ballot, for not doing your diligence as a citizen to make sure that the person you're voting for is adequate to the task. There's no closed door to hide behind anymore.
Look for those people who are interested in finding out.
Right. Well, and what is the capstone to our Bill of Rights? A frequent recurrence to the fundamental principles of the Constitution and a constant adherence to justice, moderation, temperance, industry, and frugality is indispensably necessary to preserve the blessings of liberty and good government. Therefore, the people ought to have a particular regard to those principles in the selection of their officers and representatives.
Did you just make that up?
And they have a right to require their lawgivers and magistrates an exact and constant observance of them in the formation and execution of the laws necessary for the good administration of government. When all the people out there are saying, look what jerks they are, there's three fingers pointing back at themselves. You're still recording me.
Post-production.
I think I have an ability, because of my excitement about the Constitution and where it comes from.
Obviously, yeah.
Right. To get other people. I mean, I've gotten people excited about it in the grocery store. And
of course, a little bit.
Well, yeah, I start talking to people, and there's so much in that little document. And I really mean, I think it is, in my opinion, the most perfect articulation of American liberty that there is. It has, in some ways that we've amended since, but it recognizes every fundamental liberty that we have. It is the only constitution of any sort that I know of, state or federal, or any state, federal, any place else, that makes the precise tie back to Locke's Second Treatise, which opens you up, which connects you to that whole body of political fundamental thought.